Hello and welcome back. I'm your host, Will DeGravio, and you are listening to the Video Essay Podcast, a show featuring conversations with leading critics, scholars, filmmakers, and other creators about the craft of videographic criticism. How's everybody doing? It's been a while since our last episode. A brief illness and just life generally as a graduate student derailed my getting this episode out into the world. So I do apologize for the delay, and I really appreciate everyone's patience. Hopefully going into December and the new year, I'll be able to get back on the every other week schedule. At least that's the plan for now. My guest on today's show is Chloe Galbert-Lené. The two of us discuss Chloe's desktop documentary, Watching the Pain of Others, and talk about Ross Sutherland's truly wonderful film, Stand By for Tape Backup. But before we get to my conversation with Chloe, I just want to briefly plug the Scholarship in Sound and Image Workshop at Middlebury College. Now, full disclosure, I just recently graduated from Middlebury and this past summer was the teaching assistant at the fourth iteration of the workshop. But I think I can say in a completely unbiased way, and if you don't believe me, reach out to any one of the dozens of academics who have gone through the program. The Scholarship in Sound and Image Workshop truly is a unique and wonderful experience. For those who aren't familiar with the program, it's essentially a two-week boot camp on how to produce videographic criticism that blends not only learning about the theoretical side of videographic criticism, the history of it, and how it's changing our understanding of academic scholarship, but also learning the nuts and bolts of how to produce it. You will walk away from this two-week workshop, shout out to Middlebury's own Ethan Murphy, knowing basic, even more than basic, Adobe Premiere skills and be able to return to your home institution and begin making videographic work. The way the program's designed is the first week is going through a series of videographic exercises, which Christian Keithley, Jason Mattel, and Catherine Grant outline in their book, The Videographic Essay. And then the second week is spent working on a project of your own. And it can really be on whatever you want. It could be something that supplements your current scholarship. It could be something completely new and experimental. And I think one of the great things about the program is a lot of folks go in with an idea of what they'd like to work on and then find that the experience is so generative that they completely pivot and start something new. It truly is a wonderful program and I think a really great way to learn how to do this type of work if it's something that you're interested in doing yourself. I will link to the workshop's website at thevideoessay.com for those who are interested. And now, here's my conversation with Chloe. My first question, and you and I were just talking about this before we started recording, was you hold the distinction, I say, I won't call it an honor, but you are the first guest that we've had on the show whose work we have discussed in a prior show. So listeners will remember that in episode 4 of the show with Grace Lee, who runs the YouTube channel What's So Great About That, we talked about a video essay that Chloe made with Kevin B. Lee reading Binging Benning. And we basically talked about how amazing it was. What did you think of our conversation? And I'm not fishing for compliments here, but I'd just be curious to know what it was like to hear your work talked about in that way. And if there was anything maybe that we got wrong or that, I don't know, I feel like it's only fair to give you your say in the conversation. So what'd you think?
No, it was definitely a big honor to be discussed on your show. And it was really nice of Grace to choose this video to talk about. What was very interesting for me to into in this conversation that you had with her was that you were talking quite a lot about this question of whether or not the video was scripted. Because I think one of you had this question that perhaps it was improvised. And I think she was saying that no, it was probably scripted. Really funny to me because it was so scripted. You have no idea how scripted that was. Like the laughing or like even the that we answer to each other, everything was written on the paper and it took us a good 2 days of just recording the voices for that piece so that we would try to get this sort of podcasty, you know, tone that we were trying to achieve for that piece. So that, I think for me, listening to your conversation with Grace, that was perhaps the most, at least the funniest aspect of your conversation. But it was also very interesting for me to have Grace's impression on this question of collaboration. Again, it's not necessarily something that is so common in the field of video essay or YouTube videos, the way that we make it. So again, I think that was perhaps was most interesting to me to get her thoughts about with regards to our video.
Well, thank you for your kind words. And I'm glad you finally, because I think even in that conversation, we sort of ended it like, I don't know if it's scripted. Like, I think it is, but apologies if it isn't. And this is something I do want to get into a little bit, because that seems to be an essential question when we're talking about the subgenre of video essay, that is desktop documentary. And I don't even know if you agree with my characterization of it as a subgenre. Like, we can get into that. But before we do, I think maybe I would just be interested in taking a step back and hearing a little bit more about you. Now, I know that you've given some interviews online and I've gone through and read those, and you've talked a little bit about your background and how you got interested in making video graphic work. But if you wouldn't mind just indulging us here a little bit and kind of telling us the backstory, and I'd be interested to know what was sort of the first video essays, or we'll use that term broadly, that you watched, and what about those specifically got you interested in making this kind of work yourself?
Yeah, so I got interested in the form of video essay back in 2014, 2015, because I was back then a visiting student at the University of Vienna. I took part in this class that was taught by Michael Beute, who is a maker based in Berlin, and he's been doing these workshops for many years now. He's been very influential in introducing and promoting video essay form in German-speaking countries, especially in an educational context. I took his class at the University of Vienna. I think what interested me or made me curious about enrolling in this class was because at the time I was doing additional scholarship. I was writing a master's thesis on the film of Michael Haneke that was very theoretical, classical in the form, and I was making fiction short films as a side that were traditionally produced and not especially video essayistic. I think when I realized that there was this form that was emerging, or at least it was already sort of emerged at that time, but it was still in the process of being developed, it allowed me to integrate my research practice and my taste for filmmaking and especially film editing. I think that's really what got me interested in visiting this class. And that's the context where I met first video essay that was about black narcissists, and he was looking at pattern of windows in the film and thinking about spectatorship and gaze and the film, like female gaze. Yeah, that was very much my introduction to the form.
And real quickly, because I want to transition to talking about watching The Pain of Others and specifically talk more about desktop documentaries more broadly. But I was wondering specifically, and this will be a little bit of a transition, is do you think that a desktop documentary is a video essay? Because the name itself, I feel like, implies something more, I guess maybe just the word documentary. And so this goes back to how I began the show, which is desktop documentary a subgenre of the video essay? Is it its own thing? I would just be curious to hear your thoughts on that, and then we can use that as a transition to talking about your project.
Well, I mean, if you want some full disclosure, I'm not sure I know exactly what a video essay is or is supposed to be. I do feel like, you know, we are using this term as a way to bring a community together. And I think that's a fantastic thing to do. And it's very important so that we would use the same word to gather our practices and to create a community of not only videos, but also texts about this practice and events and stuff. But I think this is where the use of the term video essay sort of stops, because then if you, I feel like the conversations that are too specific about thinking like, is this a video essay or is it a long essay film, you know, or these sort of debates. I mean, it is interesting on an ontological level, but when it comes to thinking about whether or not every desktop documentary that has been made qualifies as a video essay, I'm not sure. I don't really know. I think for me, what's the question that's important is, again, is the different institutions that are at the moment interested in video essays, compelled to consider desktop documentary as part of what they do. And it seems to be the case. So if that's the situation, then I'm happy to call what I make desktop documentary and video essay, because that's a way of creating the conversation about, you know, about our shared practices.
Absolutely. And I'll just add my reason for, I feel like I've probably asked every guest this question, and I don't know if that question will ever be answered, but I do see one of the functions of this show as kind of documenting where people are at on that question and how they perceive their work. So that is like, that's the reason behind the question. But let's use this as a segue as to talking about watching the pain of others. You go over the backstory in the essay, so I don't want to make you retell that, but I'd be interested to know sort of the nuts and bolts of the process. And what I mean by that is, how did you settle on the form of desktop documentary? Because I could see this existing in another form. And I'm sure that's something that you thought about. So I'd be interested to know about that part of the process.
I think the form I adopted for that specific project, the form of the desktop documentary, very early on. I don't really remember trying other versions. I mean, I've been playing with a lot of parameters of this video. The whole video was maybe 6 months in the making. So I tried very different things. But I'm not sure if I ever tried a version that was not desktop-based. And I think the main reason for that is, I mean, it has to do with the film that I'm talking about, right? Because the film, The Pain of Others by Penny Lane, is a documentary found footage film that is entirely made of videos that were found on YouTube. But Penny Lane extracted the videos from the YouTube platform, and you never see the YouTube interface in her film. You basically just see the videos edited one after the other. And it was such a big part of my research process to go and look for the original videos that she had appropriated to see like how they played on YouTube. And I was very interested in thinking about the difference of watching the same video as a vlog on YouTube, you know, where you can explore the channel of the person and you have the algorithm, you know, recommending you with other videos. So that creates an entire network of images and associations and words around that video. And I was very interested in thinking about how this experience of watching all of this compares to watching the video extracted from this environment and put on a big screen with virtually no other context than, you know, the other videos that it's edited with. And so I think because that was my original research question, it was very obvious that I had to reintegrate the videos in their original interfaces and therefore to record my entire desktop so as to document this, you know, entire world of frames and interfaces that contextualize these videos. And not only the vlogs that Penny Lane appropriated, but Penny Lane's film too, that has been now fed back into the online environment because it's now on Vimeo, which of course has very different associations than the YouTube interface, like the Vimeo interface connoting, you know, art film. So it was very much a research about how the interface informs our understanding of, you know, online content. So for that reason, I think, yeah, the desktop documentary form was very obvious to use.
It seems to me that the choice of the desktop documentary, the project immediately becomes about something larger than the individual film or television show or whatever the main media object is, because as you say, it immediately becomes about this broader, about the internet, about, you know, interfacing with people online. And I'm wondering if you see that, I assume you see that as one of the strengths of the desktop documentary, but I'm wondering if there's anything else about the form in particular, perhaps more broadly, that you see as perhaps like a unique aspect of it, or something that it allows you to comment on or do that other forms can't. And I don't mean that as a knock on other forms at all, just, you know, as a leader in this kind of work, I'd be interested to know your thoughts on that.
No, but it's interesting what you just said about, the thing is, yeah, when you record your entire desktop and your entire, you know, internet browser, you are recording a lot more information than what you're actually talking about. And a lot of the pleasure of making a desktop documentary, at least as far as I'm concerned, is like staging the information. So like, you know, everything that you can see on my desktop, like nothing is left, you know, at chance. It's not my personal desktop. It's like this character of a researcher that I'm building for this, you know, for this specific video that sort of has this desktop that is staged. and the bookmarks are staged. But it's interesting to think what you just said, comparing like, you know, video essays that rework only the material that they talk about versus the desktop documentary where you record more information that you can. It would be, I don't know, I see a parallel with what some people have been writing about literature versus cinema, in the sense of like, you know, literature, you'd have only the words that are chosen by the author. And if you can ignore all the situation where the character is, because the author chose to just describe, you know, her psychological state. But in cinema, because you have the camera and the world that's happening, you'll be capturing a lot more information than what you actually wanted to show. So that's just a funny parallel. But in terms of what the desktop documentary is allowing that maybe other forms of essays or video essays might not, I don't know. I mean, I wouldn't be using the desktop documentary if my research was not ultimately about the internet. I think, you know, it could easily become a gimmick. And I'm not like, I haven't seen so many desktop, you know, documentaries that didn't need to be one, because I think people who are drawn to that form is because they are investigating online media in different ways. And so I think when this is the objective, then it makes a lot of sense to be playing with the desktop interface as a frame or as a canvas. As far as I'm concerned, and I know some other practitioners have different views on that, but for me, I'm not fascinated by like the aesthetics of the desktop. I'm not so interested in recreating it with, you know, fancy animations or working with it as if it were painting or like, you know, composing images, etc. I think for me, at this point, at least, it's still very much about the documentary aspect. I'm interested in producing documents and thinking about the stakes of documenting, you know, your desktop or your internet browser on that day, knowing that for algorithmic reason, if you do it tomorrow, it's going to be very different. And I think there is a lot to think about, and we're still very much in the process of understanding how to make audiovisual documents of this online landscape that needs to be archived and is so unstable. So I think of the desktop documentary as part of this process of trying to keep imprints of the very quickly changing online world.
I have a specific question related to imprints. And I want to get to that in a minute, but I want to jump back to something fascinating you just said, which is that you play a character when you're creating these documentaries. One of my first questions that I had was, do you clean your desktop before recording? And so we know now the answer is yes.
Yes. And I choose the wallpaper, and yes, absolutely. Not only cleaning, I can add dirt also, but I do like stage it. Yeah. Not that I have to. I think I don't have to, but I like doing it.
Well, that was one of the first, because I was thinking I must have at least one embarrassing thing on my desktop that I wouldn't want to have recorded. But it almost, the way you talk about it is almost like you're directing theater. And I'm wondering, how do you balance that? And this relates to the discussion that Grace Lee and I had about reading Binging Benning, which was, it seems to me, one of the strengths of the desktop documentary is that it gives off the appearance, if done well. And as you say, I don't think I've ever seen one that I felt wasn't done well and deliberately, as if you just turned on a microphone and hit record and began to explore. But I know that it is very structured and that you put a lot of thought into it, from everything from the way your folders are arranged to when you laugh and when you talk. And apart from just like the pure skill that it takes to do that, is that something you think about in the process? And how do you balance that? Or, and I guess, do you agree with my characterization of the desktop marriage giving off that appearance of just existing?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's one of the attraction of the form, is that you feel like you're basically watching over the shoulder of someone on her laptop. And that can be, or if you're watching the film on your laptop, then it feels like your device is suddenly possessed by someone else, as like a ghost who's like moving the mouse around. And yeah. So yeah, I'm aware of it. And I think we all are who work with this form. And yet, of course, it's still very, very much, again, staged and controlled. And I think I have an evolving relationship to this question, because my instinct is to keep the desktop as, you know, realistic as possible, if you want to call it that. So I am reluctant to making things happen on the screen that actually cannot happen on the laptop. But then There are moments in the film Watching the Pain of Others where you have superpositions or super impressions of one image on top of the other, or you have this moment when I use my phone and like suddenly you see the screen of my phone on the, of course that's not possible in live, that's obviously edited, and it's not even pretending to be real, you know. But I think what's funny to me is that when I hear people responding to this video, I can tell that like some people will totally ignore these moments of things happening that are not supposed to happen because they are so immersed in the narrative that they want to believe that it's all happening live. And some other people actually find it super fascinating to be tracking like all of the like uncanny moments when some things happen on the desktop that are not, you know, actually possible. But it's interesting to me to think that different people will take different things from the experience. Because again, like, you know, when I talk about this film in an academic context, nobody cares about the fact that I'm staging my desktop. Like, this is not relevant. We'd never talk about this at all. But with a film audience, then that suddenly becomes like, you know, funny or interesting to think about, talking about, you know, character development or these sort of issues. And I enjoy the fact that the desktop documentary offers so many, you know, options or parameters to play with that different audiences are going to respond to differently.
I want to jump back to this question of imprints. So in the piece, you mention that The Pain of Others, so the documentary, is, and I'm going to quote you directly here, is an imprint of a certain state of the world. And that is in reference to, and I always say this, but please go watch Chloe's desktop documentary before we listening. Like, so pause now and then come back later, because it's obviously well worth your time and amazing. But I think we don't want to spend a lot of time summarizing the video essay when it's available for free consumption online. But basically, you're in reference to one of the women in the film has given up vlogging and blogging after saying that she was perpetuating. I thought this was interesting. She puts it, the word issue, in quotes. Now, obviously, I think anything that's on the internet is fair game to be used. And Penny Lane and both of you reached out to the women whose videos that you quote and, you know, to see if they would like to participate in the project. But I'm wondering that this question of an imprint. Yes, this woman put up a video of herself, and that's something that she chose to do, but she has since changed. And your video essay captures that change, and The Pain of Others does not. And I'm wondering if your video essay is a critique of this practice. And I mean critique in like the broadest sense. I don't mean like a takedown, angry critique, but it does raise an interesting ethical question about the practice. And I'm wondering if you could speak a little bit more to that.
Well, I mean, of course, these are issues that I think, you know, Penny Lane in the first place and I were very, very aware of, thinking about the ethics of, again, documenting not only someone without her knowledge or without her formal consent, but again, as you said, in the case of this person who has taken down every video she had put on YouTube after Penny Lane made her film. So some of the videos that this person wanted gone from the internet are now saved on Vimeo because of Penny Lane's film and now because also of mine. So I think, yeah, we were both very much aware of this question, and I find it interesting that we responded to it in different ways. And I think, you know, if there is an answer to this very difficult question, it probably makes a lot of sense that we come up with different strategies, so at least we can have an informed conversation about how to deal with these questions. As far as I'm concerned, what I tried to do in the film was to be explicit enough about my own doubts and my own concerns about working with this material, and to verbalize and again and enact this character that who would, you know, make these questions very addressed to the spectator. I wanted it to be so explicit and so self-reflexive that at least you as an audience, you know, of my video would be able to think about the question. And then if you disagree with the ethical decision that I made, it's fine. As long as I gave you an opportunity to think about that issue, I think that is the most important. If you're afraid of these ethical issues and you just censor your practice, and, you know, for sure there are some moments when it's better to not touch certain things because they might be too dangerous or it's just not the right moment, but When, I mean, for in that specific case, I had the intimate feeling that it was at least okay to try to have a conversation about that state of the internet and what people do when they put video out there, because they know it's going to stay there. Like, I think at this point, we are all, as social media users, collectively aware that what you put on the internet, you won't, you know, remove from the internet. You can, you know, close your account. It's not going to go anywhere. It's somewhere, you know? So, and I think, and eventually I think this is what made it okay, in my own head at least, to use the videos of these women in my film, is that it's not about them. I think it's pretty clear that, you know, I'm not talking about them as persons. I don't know them, and I do have, you know, respect for them, and I talk about my relationship with them in the film. So, and it's my sincere hope that there's nothing in the film that is, you know, either disrespectful or that is violating their privacy. But it is interesting to me to use a little bit of their material to talk about something that is bigger than them, which is exactly this question of what is an online archive and how do we contribute our personal data to this chaotic, you know, ensemble of media that is controlled by nobody but accessible to a lot of people.
Speaking of films that are on Vimeo, let us transition to Stand By for Tape Backup, which is the piece that you selected for us to talk about. And for those listening, it's a little over an hour, so
but
I know
totally
that
worth your time. It's absolutely worth your time. Go watch it. It's a really great film.
I could not agree more. I'm so happy that you chose it. And so please do go watch it at thevideoessay.com, where it is embedded. And so I'll turn it over to you a little bit with kind of just the first general question, which is, why did you select this for us to talk about? And what specifically about it, I guess, do you find compelling?
Yeah, I chose it because, well, I think it's probably my favorite video essay that exists. And it's actually among my favorite films, like, you know, in every category is brought together. I find it really fascinating. And I rewatched it again yesterday to prepare for this conversation. And I'm happy to say that I still find it really good. I don't know, I guess in the specific context of thinking about the conversations that are happening in the world of the video essay, I think that this film, for me, points in at least two directions that I find really interesting and fascinating and underexplored, I would say. On the one hand, the fact that it's a video essay that talks, arguably it is about film, but it doesn't end there. Like, it's using film and media to talk about something broader that's more about the experience of, yeah, being confronted with media, but then also just the experience of being human, I guess, or alive, which is what a lot of great artworks have in common. And then maybe more specifically, I always think about this piece, and it's been a really important influence. I mean, I wish it was more of an influence on my work, but I definitely think about it every time, thinking about performance. Because I find the writing is amazing, but the vocal performance that Ross Sutherland delivers in this film, I find absolutely amazing. And it's, I mean, of course, then Ross Sutherland has a background. I mean, he is a performer. That's what he, you know, does, this and poetry originally. So, of course, he has skills that most of us do not have. I mean, I definitely do not have the capacity of producing such vocal performance. But I always think about it when I'm in the process of trying to record a voice or even just writing, because he writes in such a way that it's never explanatory. It's never, it never positions itself in this position of authority. Like, let me tell you what there is to know about this film. It's always more personal, which of course creates another form of authority, but it's not like anchored in knowledge that is being transferred to you as an audience. It's more of a confession. And I think because my recent video work, at least in the last couple of years, I've been trying to capture something that was perhaps more about my affective responses to films, perhaps more so than, you know, performing cold analysis of the structures of the films that I was discussing. I always think of this film by Ross Sutherland as a fantastic example of someone who does just that, who performs affective states in front of different films and media. Mm.
I see a lot of parallels between his piece and your work.
Oh, thank
for
you.
For sure. What I like about it is that it almost functions as an artifact. And I mean that in two ways. And one is that there's the actual artifact, which is the VHS tape that he uses as a symbol of his childhood and as a mechanism to understand his past and his relationship with his grandfather. But it's also a media artifact, in that the video essay is digitizing a VHS tape, So we get, I get, for lack of a better word, we get like the texture of the image that goes with the VHS tape. I'm young, but I'm not, I'm probably the last generation that went to like Blockbuster Video and got VHS tape. So if I'm using the wrong terminology, please, if there's a better way of phrasing this, but I think people know what I mean, and how it contributes to the overall aesthetic of the piece, and it lends this authenticity to it. And I wonder if you could speak a little bit about texture, because it seems to me that that is also an important facet of the desktop documentary and capturing what is, I guess, the texture of the digital, which feels so normal to us now. But I imagine that in, you know, 20 years from now, when we have something that's completely different, one will be able to grasp that texture. And I'm wondering if that's something that you think about in your own work.
Yeah. No, yeah. I want to respond to just like, because, yeah, as I said, I rewatched Ross Sutherland's film yesterday, and I had this exact, you know, a thought that was very close to what you just said, because I was watching it on a television, like, you know, a living room television. And it was, but I was screening it from an HDMI cable that was showing it from my Vimeo, obviously. And that was such a loop of like bringing television back onto television, but like filtered through, you know, the computer. So it was a very interesting experience. But yeah, thinking about texture, well, you don't even have to wait 20 years, I think, for the appearance or the texture of the digital desktop to feel outdated or just, you know, not even vintage, but just old. Like, I had this experience a couple years ago when I was showing the film Redacted, the Palmas Redacted, to some of my students who are, so, you know, maybe 10 years younger than I am, which is not such a generational gap. But if you remember in the film, you do have some moments when you see the interface of a computer. But that was, now I'm going to get this wrong. Let's say it was around 10 years ago. I'm not sure exactly. I remember the exact date of the film. But their response to that was like, oh my God, that looks so old. Like those desktop interfaces, this is so, you know, like 2000-ish something. And it was fascinating for me to see that, of, you know, a form that is so obviously contemporary ages so quickly. And so I think if you think about it in those terms, it's very easy to fear that the desktop documentaries that we're making now, which seems so, you know, real because we understand every aspect of it because it is our natural environment, perhaps even more so than like walking in a street, we just, you know, stare at the desktop, you know, all day, at least I do, to think that this experience might be lost in even like 3, 4, 5 years. And if you feel like the immediacy is the main component of the aesthetic experience of the desktop documentary, then it seems very likely that this experience will be lost very soon. Fortunately, I think there is another interest in the form, which relates to, again, what we're discussing earlier about, you know, the archive value of this work, because I do feel that keeping, again, an imprint or a document of how digital interfaces looked like and felt like and how you navigated through, you know, an online environment in the late 2019 is going to have, at least if nothing else, a documentary value for like future media archaeologists who will want to go back in time to see what were the textures like back then. But I'm really curious to see when, if ever, these digital, like very high definition, if that becomes vintage. That's going to be really interesting, I think. Because I think we can already see that the very pixelated, like early YouTube aesthetic is becoming interesting for filmmakers to work with. So we'll see if this very sharp, you know, desktop interface also has this destiny of becoming, you know, interestingly, quote unquote, analog media to work with in like 10 years.
Well, it is fascinating how we become so desensitized to change. I'm thinking specifically, I see screenshots of how even just like the iPhone interface looked even 2 years ago, and I have almost no memory of that, or even the old like Twitter interface. And as you say, like media archaeologists will be interested in that as well. But it also relates to the idea of spectatorship and of going with your grandfather and selecting certain images to tape. And within that, there's an element of randomness, but also an element of priority, of saying there's only a set amount of time on this VHS tape that we can record. Well, we have to have Ghostbusters on there. Like it's very much about the process and what it was like to be a spectator at that time. And that itself is an essential question to understanding our personal connection to films. And you get that obviously through his narration, but the technical side as well conveys that in a powerful way as well.
Yeah. But, you know, I think this is, I mean, what you just said, I think you can quote and like make it the definition of what's interesting about the video essay form in general, at least for me. It's like it's documenting modes of spectatorship. I mean, that's the reason why I'm interested in the forms. That's the reason why I watch video essays, you know, on a regular basis. It's not that I can learn about films. It's because I want to see people, different people, which also means that we need various people to be making video essays to have diverse perspectives. But you see different people watching films, and that is what's fascinating to me. It's this relationship that is built between the individual and the media. And again, I think what is so amazing about the film of Ross Sutherland is that he owns this spectatorial position so much, making it so personal and so performative, that you really get a sense that there is this, yeah, this relationship between the person and the object that becomes very much the topic of the film, more so that the film that Ghostbusters, or, you know, the advertisement that he's showing on the
Chloe,
screen.
Thank you so much for agreeing to be on the show. I really appreciate you taking the time.
Thank you.